Microfinance institutions usually charge microenterprises very high interest rates to cover the cost of having to monitor them intensely. Therefore, borrowing from MFIs is likely to be worthwhile only if the businesses have very high returns. So, do microenterprises have high returns, and are they constrained by a lack of access to credit? Let's take a look at a study from Sri Lanka that attempts to answer these questions. In this study, microenterprises were given grants to invest in their business. The authors used the impact of these grants to measure the return to capital. They found that on average, the return to capital was about 5.3% per month. This works out to over a 60% annual return, which is quite high. The authors also found that returns for entrepreneurs with more assets was on average 2.4% lower. This suggests that richer entrepreneurs were able to use their assets to operate their business closer to its optimal scale. This finding indicates that microenterprises are a credit constraint. Why? If microenterprises were not credit constrained, then poorer entrepreneurs should be able to borrow to expand their business until their returns were the same as the returns for richer entrepreneurs. This clearly was not happening. Since microenterprises do have high returns, do they grow and increase their profits when they borrow from MFIs? The evidence is generally positive, but not clear-cut. While many studies find MFI lending increases investment, sales, and profits, others find little impact or even decreased business activity. So why isn't there clear evidence of positive effects? Let's explore some possible reasons. First, it could be the case that the impact takes a long time to show up. Most studies only look at the impact of microcredit on short-term outcomes. Maybe microenterprises are using microcredit to make investments that takes time to pay off. Another reason could be that the positive benefits for some microentrepreneurs is being hidden by no benefits for others. Microentrepreneurs are a very heterogeneous group. They vary on many important factors, such as their business skill, level of education, and goals for their business. A recent study in India shows that heterogeneity in motivation is quite important for outcomes. The authors divided up the entrepreneurs into two groups. They called one group gung-ho entrepreneurs, and these were people who had started their business before microfinance showed up in their community. And they called the other group reluctant entrepreneurs, and these were people who only opened their business after microfinance showed up. The key idea is that if a person is willing to start a business when credit is hard to get, then they are probably more motivated to grow their business. The study's findings confirm this idea. Gung-ho entrepreneurs receive substantial benefits when microfinance opens in their community, while reluctant entrepreneurs experience little gain. A third reason could be that microloans are ill-suited to finance the investment opportunities available to microenterprises. Microloans require quick repayment and have joint liability. Quick repayment makes it difficult to finance investments that take time to pay off. With joint liability, other members of the group are penalized when a risky but profitable investment fails, but don't capture the benefits when it succeeds. Therefore, the group may discourage such investment. If microloans are not well suited for financing investment, then what are some alternative ways to help microenterprises? One option might be microsavings, which have been found to have positive effects on microenterprises. Microsavings could help by offering entrepreneurs a way to accumulate funds over time, which they can later invest in their business. Reducing the risk of investment may also be helpful. Insurance can reduce risk for the entrepreneur and encourage investment by providing a floor on their income when returns are low. Social programs, such as conditional cash transfer programs, can serve this purpose since they limit how low the entrepreneur's income can fall. Another way to reduce risk is by using equity to finance investment. However, microequity products are hard to design, since overcoming moral hazard among microenterprises is especially challenging. Finally, microcredit products may be redesigned to better meet the needs of microenterprises. For example, the requirement of frequent repayment can be relaxed. An Indian microfinance institution compared the performance of a credit line with a term loan. The credit line offered the client the option to withdraw when needed and to pay back during the term of the credit line. The loan gave the borrower the full amount upfront and required regular payments. people offered the credit line had much higher profits, and the increase in profits was due to better quality of goods and lower input costs.